Welcome to October's Coastal Garden. You know, we're right here beginning of fall, and you may not be thinking about getting out in the landscape and planting trees and shrubs and doing all of that. We think about that probably a lot more in the spring, but this is the perfect time to plant trees and shrubs. The days are shorter and cooler. You won't have to worry about so much the irrigation problems you do with planting in the spring. So getting out and planting all of these plants right now is the perfect thing to do. We have a new project here at the Arboretum. This is over on the Bradley Drive side, and we're gonna get Mark Weekly, who is our Arboretum coordinator and does a lot of our choosing plants and doing a lot of the design. And Mark's gonna join us and talk a little bit specifically about this project. And then later on in the show, we'll take you through how you might approach a project at your own place. So Mark, thanks for joining us here on the show.
Thank you.
Tell us a little bit about the background of what happened here on this Bradley Drive entrance to the Arboretum.
Well, we had an old traffic pattern that just wasn't working for us. And one of our issues is a lack of parking for events. And another issue is we're just pretty much running out of garden space. So we had the opportunity to fix things a little better, make entrance and exit a little easier, plus creating another new garden while we're at it.
And I guess one of the big things that was driving this was the fact that it is a pretty dangerous place to get in and out of, and some of the traditional entrances, so pulling it over here is certainly safer for the public coming in and out, as you mentioned. So you mentioned parking and some issues. You know, anytime we approach a landscape project, whether it's a place here at the Arboretum or a place at your house or whatever, you're always looking at the logical, what are you trying to create and how people are going to use it, I guess, to a degree. You mentioned the parking. We're standing here on a turf area. What was the purpose of putting all this in?
Well, we don't usually have that much attendance that we need to have all this parking. So a nice skirt of turf across the front is always a nice way to set off a bed. But it does give us an area that for an evening or a weekend, we can have parking on and off of it. It's not going to do too much damage, and it gets people off the street.
Well, and one thing about it, if you park people out here on the street and they've got to go there, you got to give them some way to get there, don't you? And that's kind of, I guess, tell us a little bit about why you put the walkway in here, what the stone does for you, the design aspects of that.
Well, it's human nature to take the shortest path through. So we figured instead of having people making their own, we'd give them a set path to follow and make it as nice and safe for them as we could.
So from a standpoint of creating this, was there any, I mean, is there a reason that you chose this particular stone to go here or there, or is it just an idea of catching people's attention?
Mainly we set the large boulders at the entrance, try to catch the attention so they'd know where to enter and exit. But a lot of times, like we do here, we've taken one part of a garden apart and rebuilt it somewhere else and reused.
Well, it keeps the budget down a little bit anyway.
Yeah.
These are fairly large flagstones that are just set on the ground. They're not sitting on a base or anything. And I know some people struggle with that. How do I know which stone to use? How do I get them stabilized and all that? Can you give us some pointers on that?
Well, we wanted to cover as much distance as possible since we were limited. So we tried to position the stones to give us the greatest linear length as possible. And after that, it's just a matter of picking the best side with no toe stubbers and try to have some sort of texture so it'll grip when it's been raining or something. But other than that, it's just a big old puzzle. You work until you get it right.
Yeah, you know when you got it right, but you can't always tell everybody else how to do it. Well, one thing what would you tell people, and I see a lot of home gardeners, when you go buy stone here, stone's fairly expensive. And some of these stones, you look at them, they're fairly thick, and that means they're heavy, which means they're even more expensive. But is there an advantage to using these big, thick pieces of stone versus some thinner stuff?
Well, the thicker stones won't walk as much, and that's one thing we had to do with each stone is you have to get it level and stationary. You've got to match it up to the neighbor so the plane stays the same, and it's got to be sturdy. If you step on one corner, it flips up, you've wasted your time.
We get sued then, wouldn't we?
Yeah.
All right, well, no, so we've got the parking issues, we've got the access issues of getting people from point A to point B, and that's the same thing you do in a residential landscape too. But the fun stuff for people like you, I know, are the plants. So I see some things, some gold things out here, and, and that's something I know you're into pretty heavily right now. Tell us a little bit about some of the plants you chose out here and why you chose them.
Okay. Well, like you said, I am getting into gold this year for some reason. It's my first love of the plants out here was this new Golden Shore juniper. Mm-hmm. People know the Blue Shore, and I just did it as a kind of a checkerboard across the front just to you know, jazz it up a little bit. Once they grow in together, you get that nice repeat of color and pattern across.
And that'll tend to soften the wall, soften some of that, because as you mentioned, these are going to spread probably 6 feet or so, aren't they, each? So they'll grow yep. all together. Yep. Kind of hard to imagine that right now, but so you'll get gold and blue-green mm-hmm. repeated, as you mentioned.
Yeah.
You've got a gardenia here that's showing a lot of gold, and you know, a lot of people look at that and say, something wrong with that one?
Yeah.
But that's not the case with this one, is it?
No, it's one of the first truly variegated gardenias. Mm-hmm. It actually in the spring will come out a chartreuse green, mm-hmm. and then as summer goes and the heat increases, it'll turn more to a pure gold. But it's just like any of the others, gets 4 to 5 feet tall, 5 to 6 wide. The only real difference other than the gold is it has a 5-inch double blossom on it when it does bloom.
Huge, huh?
Huge for
gardenia.
Well,
we'll look forward to seeing that next spring. I see a kind of a weird looking conifer just kind of behind me over here.
Mm-hmm.
You got to tell us a little bit about that one.
That's one of those I saw it and had to have it plants before I even knew much about it. It's a Cryptomeria japonica. That one is cristata, but it's known as the coxcomb Cryptomeria. And if you look at it, it looks like the old fashioned flower, the coxcomb flower, the celosia.
Yeah, and that's a for those who don't know the Latin, that's what some would call Japanese cedar, mm-hmm. and it is one of the conifers that tends to do reasonably well
mm-hmm.
here. Lots of different ones, small growers, larger growers.
Yeah.
How long have we had this one in the garden?
We've had it here since February.
Okay. A little early to tell yet, but a really interesting growth habit, as you mentioned. It looks like the old coxcomb flower. What other plants have you got out here that you just think are going to be the coolest things since sliced bread?
Well, we'll have a couple of explosions of pink out here in early spring. Mm-hmm. Lasts about a month. It's a new cherry, the Himalayan cherry.
Mm-hmm.
It's a Prunus jackmontii. And just, we have one in the welcome garden mm-hmm. that this spring was solid pink for an entire month.
Yeah, we had that one on Facebook, I know, several mm-hmm. times, and it blooms early and really a spectacular flower. So you've got those spotted in here.
Mm-hmm.
I see some Indian hawthorns over there. That's a plant that a lot of people probably don't get all that excited about, but this is a little different than the typical mm-hmm. Indian hawthorn, isn't it?
Yeah, this is a variety called Redbird, mm-hmm. and all the new tips on it are really nice, deep, bright red. So
a little bit early to tell whether that's going to be a good choice for us or not, but.
Yeah.
You've added a couple of crepe myrtle cultivars. That's something else we've been trying to do here in the garden at the Arboretum is get some more crepe myrtle cultivars that we didn't have. So you've added Catawba, I think, the purple mm-hmm. one, and a Sioux, and hopefully we'll find an Osage before
yeah.
it's over with to put right back behind here. Is there anything else out here in the garden that you just think that somebody ought to know about?
Well, a lot of people love Yaupon hollies just because they're
tough.
Pretty much indestructible.
Yeah.
Plant it and forget it. We have a new variety called Micron, which has a very tiny, tiny leaf, would make an excellent bonsai specimen,
mm-hmm.
but just a beautiful, tight, eventually 3 by 3 foot shrub.
Yeah, and I think, a lot of cases you talk about dwarf plants and dwarf yaupon, as you mentioned, an incredibly tough plant,
mm-hmm.
tolerates all our conditions very well. But a lot of cases they get too large.
Yeah.
You know, they grow 5 feet by 5 feet and they swallow people's windows. So. This one called Micron might be the case if
yep.
you have the patience to wait for it.
Yeah, it's a very slow grower.
Yeah, but the texture is really neat. Lots of backdrop here with some of the encore azaleas that, of course, are blooming great. And we're going to talk a little bit about those toward the end of the show, some of the ones that are really pretty this time of year.
Mm-hmm.
Anything else you think the folks out there need to know about our new garden here next to Bradley at the Arboretum?
Well, like I say, we just took a disadvantage and turned it around and made a very positive part, a nice entrance for people, safe parking, safe egress to the rest of the garden, and do the best you can.
Mark, the project already looks a whole lot better than it did, and we'll certainly enjoy watching it as it develops. So thanks for making that happen.
You're welcome.
Stick with us after the break. We'll get you working in your landscape and give you some tips on how you can be as successful as the project here at the Arboretum. Welcome back. You know, we kind of looked at the design aspect of things. Now we're going to get down to the nitty-gritty of playing in the soil, or if you want to call it dirt. If you've lived in southeastern North Carolina very long, you know, we don't have very good soils to grow a lot of plants we like to grow. Now, if you look here at a bed we're working on in the Arboretum, you'll see these pine fines on the top here, and you'll see topsoil that's been added. This is what we have to do in a lot of our locations to grow things like azaleas and camellias and gardenias that need that really high organic matter soil, great drainage. It just is the only way you're going to have success with them. Now, there's always a negative side to everything that you do, and one of the things that you can get is you can bring in problems with topsoil. You can bring in nematodes, weed problems, those kind of things. So it's a crapshoot to a degree when you start doing that, but in the case like we have here at the Arboretum, it's our only choice if we want to grow some of these plants. The other thing is getting the pH right, the fertility right. You know, we always encourage in cooperative extension to do the soil samples. Still a great idea to do that, figure out all of the basic stuff so that once you've got the high organic matter soil, the good drainage, the right pH, the good fertility, your plants will have that best chance to succeed in the landscape. Now, all this talk about adding organic matter and topsoil and all that doesn't apply to every plant that we grow. It does apply to a lot of those like the azaleas and camellias and gardenias. But if you're growing a lot of hollies and junipers and Indian hawthorns and plants like that, as long as the drainage is decent, you break the soil up with the rototiller, you get the fertility right, they're going to do just fine. So it a lot of times boils down to what you're trying to grow, what fits in that particular location. Again, that old thing about the right plant in the right place with the right kind of conditions, and you'll have great success with them. One of the questions a lot of times people ask about planting is, should I dig an individual hole or prep an entire bed? And the politician's answer to that is, it depends. If you're talking about large trees out in a big open area where you're just planting one individual by itself, and you really doesn't make any sense to prepare an entire bed, then the idea of that is whatever comes out of that hole goes back in with that plant. Because if that plant is going to be successful, it's got to, quote, learn how to live in that environment, in that soil condition. If you're talking about plants like we are here in this bed, and like we're going to plant the gardenia that we're about to plant, those are planted in these beds where you would prepare the entire place so that you have, to use the fancy terminology, a homogeneous root area. It's all the same. So you don't get these interfaces where the roots don't grow together very well. So it little depends on what you're doing. Big trees, individuals, what comes out of the hole goes back in. Out here in these azalea beds, camellia beds, and gardenia beds, rototilling and mixing and getting it all together is really the right way to have success. So let's go take a look at that gardenia and get it in the ground. Now, we've gotten most of the soil preparation done, and that is important, especially with things like these azaleas, gardenias, and camellias. You see we've mixed it all really well. We did it with a hoe and a shovel here. You could do that with a rototiller. You may have noticed some little yellow beads in the soil there as we were mixing that in. That's actually 90% sulfur. And one of the things about the soil here is that the pHs are high, and that's pretty common along the coast. So sometimes you're going to need to be adding sulfur and mixing it in, much like you do lime to raise the pH. We have the opposite problem in this bed because of the irrigation water. The pH is too high. We want to drive it down a little bit. Otherwise, when we're ready to plant a plant from a container, you know, this is a relatively small little gallon and a half container here, but you knock it out of the container and you'll see typically that you have a lot of roots along the outer edge. And this one's not too bad, actually. This is just about perfect. It's got good form, but they're not circling. One of the things we always talk about with planting container plants is if you do have a lot of these circling roots, that you want to loosen that up a little bit, because the roots will tend to have a memory and they'll keep growing round and round and round and not venture out into the soil. So take a pair of pruners, or in this case where you just got relatively easy to do, just take your fingers, break that root ball up just a little bit, loosen those roots up. And then, you know, we prepared this so well that I can do this with my own, just with hands. But we've got a fairly shallow root ball on this little plant, this little gardenia. And we're already in a raised bed. So you hear people a lot of times talking about planting high. You wouldn't need to do that here. It wouldn't even be desirable. So you want to plant where that top of that root ball is about even with the soil here. Firm it up. Get the plant set like you want it. Plants do have a face, so sometimes they look better turned one way or the other. You see we've got that. We're going to just backfill around with the soil that we scraped out. Firm it a little bit with your fingers. You don't want to stomp it or really compact it. And the last step in getting this little plant going is that we're going to water it in. The watering is really important because what that will do is you'll get rid of any of the air pockets. So it's almost impossible, especially on larger plants, not to have some spaces there. So what the water will do is find those air pockets and collapse them, and then you can backfill a little bit more once you finish. So really the main thing is to loosen the root ball up. Don't plant too deep, but again, don't plant so shallow in a raised bed. Get the pH and all the fertility right. You won't have any problems with growing a plant like this little gardenia. But the other thing to remember, anytime you're doing landscaping, all that stuff we talked about with the project over at the Arboretum, you know, the right plant, the soil preparation we've talked a lot about, that right plant in the right place, very important. You don't want something that's going to overgrow the site. We have a filtered shade area. It works really well for things like azaleas and hydrangeas and all of that. Not so well for plants that need full sun. So all that's really important. The soil prep and all of that is very important to making a successful job, but it's even more important to plan and choose plants that fit where you're growing them. And, you know, as the days get shorter and the nights grow longer, you don't have as much time to get out and enjoy the garden. And one of the great things we can do is with low voltage lighting, we can light up that garden at night and double your pleasure. And when we come back from the break, we'll show you a little bit about that. Here in the Coastal Gardener, you know, we got everything in the ground, the mulch is back around, and we told you we're going to talk a little bit about landscape lighting, low voltage lighting in this particular case. One of the things when we talk about lighting in a landscape, you can do it with line bulbs, but obviously you'd have to be an electrical contractor to do that legally. This uses a stranded copper wire, a 12 volt system, so it's not something that you have to have a contractor's license to install. There are all kinds of different ways to do lighting in a landscape. Probably the simplest thing is just to go get the little kits that you see in some of the mass merchandisers or garden shops. Not the greatest lights in the world. It's like anything else. You get what you pay for. So usually when we talk about using lighting, we use some of the other cast aluminum products or some of the polypropylene products that hold up really well here along the coast. But we'll talk a little bit more about the componentry here in a minute. I wanted to tell you a little bit about some of the effects that you can create. As the nights do get longer, the trees lose their leaves. If you have things like Japanese maples, like we have in this landscape, crepe myrtles with pretty bark, they lose their foliage, and the lighting, especially up lighting on them, gives you beautiful pictures of the form of that plant all through the evening. You get to enjoy that plant all through the winter. Really more, even more attractive in the winter than it is in the summer as far as the lighting goes. You have to be careful with up lighting though, because if you use too much of it, it won't be a pleasing effect. Up lighting causes us to see light very differently than we normally do. If you think about it, light usually comes from sunlight and it's coming down upon you, not rising up from the ground. So it really does catch your eye. That's a good thing if used in moderation. Typically what we do with these plants like Japanese maples and crepe myrtles that have pretty form, depending on the size of the canopy, we'll mount these spotlights kind of in the ground around the canopy, put them opposite each other, maybe even three or four lights on that to really get some depth to the field of light so you get all sides of the stems. Really looks nice done that way, but again, don't overdo that because it will kind of become distracting if you use too much of it. One of the other things that's typically used, and it's like the little kits you can buy, is pathway lighting. And you can spend enormous sums of money on fancy pathway lights. We don't have any of those here. These are copper lights and they work really well. But basically what you're doing there is just trying to show people where they need to walk. A lot of times you put them near the steps if you've got to step up or step down, light that area. Use lights typically that have some kind of hood over them that causes the light to spread and go out around on the walkway or the ground, just so people can see what they're doing. One of the most interesting effects you can get with landscape lighting is what we call moonlighting. It's called that because it kind of mimics moonlight on a bright night. It's up above your head. It's filtered down through limbs of trees. It catches all kinds of different shapes and spreads them out on the ground or on a patio or a walkway. Really get some interesting effects with moonlighting. It's a little more difficult though, obviously, because you got to go up in the trees. And in this case, we're on pine trees and they're mounted directly to the trunks. If you were in, say, oaks or something with larger canopies, you would spot them where they would give you nice, gentle light all across the ground. You don't want this to be bright. You don't want to blind people when they look up to see where the fixtures are. And you kind of want to hide the fixtures as much as you can so you just get the effect of the light and not the fixture and the brightness of that directly. So once you've figured out what works in your landscape, whether it's the uplighting, pathway lighting, the moon lighting, depending on the plant material and what you have, there are other effects you can create too, silhouetting plants on walls, lighting up the structures so it really makes things pop at night. Many, many things you can do. When you decide on the componentry though and what you're gonna do, buy the best stuff you can afford. It's like anything else, you get what you pay for. Here with transformers especially, get the ones with the stainless steel cases. I like to use one that has a photocell that will turn the lights on when it gets dark, and then a timer that will turn them off later. Because most of us don't need our lights on all night. That'll save you some bulb life, save you a little bit of electricity. These lights don't take a lot of electricity anyway. It will save you the changing of the bulbs and having to replace them so often. When it comes to mounting the transformer and getting that photocell, the easiest place to put the photocells like this one is attached to the case. Of course, the transformer's got to be somewhere close to an electrical outlet, somewhere outside. You don't have to have the photocell directly with sunlight pouring into it. It just needs to be exposed so that when it gets dark, it will shift and turn the lights on. Like I said, this one has a timer that will shut it off usually 1-2 o'clock in the morning after you've gone to bed. A couple of things about low voltage lighting. You don't have to have the contractor's license, as I mentioned, but it does require a little bit of knowledge about how you put the wires together, the types of wiring you use, the connectors. So if all of that's something you don't want to deal with, the best thing to do would be get a contractor to handle that for you. One of the really cool things that's happened with low voltage lighting in recent times is these LED or light emitting diode bulbs and fixtures that you can purchase. Now they're fairly pricey, but several good things about light emitting diodes. One is they last a long, long time. The box here says this one will last 36 years in use. Don't know if that's true or not, but they do last at least 10 times longer than your typical halogen type bulbs. And that's really important for a couple of things. One, LEDs don't produce a lot of heat, and that can really create some problems, especially on uplighting, where you're putting that fixture right down in the mulch. You get a lot of heat generated, pine needles, things like that may catch fire. The other great thing about LEDs is putting them in those moonlights. Because you have to get up there to change those bulbs, if you got one that lasts 10 years rather than 2 years, that means a lot less trouble to get up there and get those bulbs replaced. So LEDs make a lot of sense, even though you're gonna pay at least probably 4 or 5 times for each bulb, but it's certainly worth it for all the advantages. So that's a little bit about using low voltage lighting. You know, it's a relatively easy thing to do. The main thing is to figure out, do I have the plants that work? What kind of things am I gonna create? You can create all kinds of beautiful patterns, and it's a good thing from a safety standpoint, getting people through your landscape. And it's a fun thing to do if you like to play in the garden. So that's just a quick look at landscape lighting. Obviously there's more to it than just what we've said, but think about the effects you're trying to create, the components, and if you really don't want to get involved in that, hire somebody that knows what they're doing. You'll add so much to the landscape and get a whole nother dimension that you can enjoy, especially through the winter, but every night. Speaking of enjoying things, you know, 20 years ago, we never thought much about azaleas that bloomed except those 2 weeks in the spring because we really didn't have a lot. And then along came encores and bloomathons and all of these plants that are really beautiful this time of year. So we're going to finish up the show this time with some great pictures of some of the encores and bloomathons and even some of the reblooming hydrangeas that are absolutely gorgeous in the fall. So enjoy those and we'll look forward to seeing you next month.
Thank you.